Hello and welcome along once again to It'll Be Alright in the 90s. Nostalgia. Together, we'll crack it. I'm Stu Joslin and joining me, as always, is Alex Greenwood. Greenie, how are you, mate? And from that little laugh you gave there, I can tell you understand the reference there in the intro.
I don't. It sounds familiar, but I don't know exactly what it is.
Okay.
I was just amused by the familiarity of it. please confirm what it is.
Car crime. Together we'll crack it.
Oh, of course it is, yes. Perfect. I'm good. Yeah, this is an interesting topic. Something maybe a bit more serious than we normally do, or potentially more serious than we normally do. So we'll see how it goes.
We'll give it a light touch and try not to get too grisly. I don't think we want to do that, do we? We don't want to get into that area.
I know. As popular as that is in today's cultural landscape, we don't want to... It's not a bandwagon we want to jump onto.
No. There are plenty of other podcasts that will serve that far better than us. So if you weren't able to tell from the introduction, tonight we're looking at crime in the 90s. And we've got a very suitable sponsor for tonight's episode as well, because tonight we are sponsored by the good people at Krooklok. Just quote the code ALRIGHT90s to receive 10% off any stop lock or disc lock product at participating branches of Argos. That's Krooklok, prevents car crime.
Fantastic, yeah. With the nights drawing in and more darkness, it's the sort of time when you really want to be protecting your Ford Fiestas and your Orions and whatnot with some better car security. So that's a fantastic time for them to get on board, and we're glad to have them as sponsors.
Yes, thank you very much. And if you could send through a couple of disc locks, I always really like those, the massive metal discs that just clamped over the steering wheel and just locked in place. If only I had one on the blue Ford Fiesta back in 2008. Yeah. You know, who knows? It might still be driving it today.
Yeah, we used to have one of the ones that went on the hooked from the steering wheel down to the brake pedal or whatever it was in the Ford Escort Mark IV, of course, and it protected it just fine. It was never stolen. It did end up upside down in a ditch, but that was because we sold it to a ne'er-do-well, not realizing that it was going to be used for something dodgy, but it was never stolen. So testament to the power of the Krooklok. Stu, I've got a question for you. What is your favourite TV detective's car?
There can only be one.
I know what you're going to say, but go on.
Spender's Ford Sierra Cosworth.
Yes, I thought that's what you would say. I'm going to actually give you a quick quiz. That was going to be one of my questions. I'm going to give you a detective name. I want you to say what their car is.
Okay.
So first off is Inspector Morse.
Jaguar Mark II.
Correct. Bergerac.
Oh, Bergerac. That's a difficult one. I'm going to say Triumph of some sort.
Yeah, bang on. Yeah, Triumph Roadster, 1947 Triumph Roadster. So a real oldie there.
Excellent.
And finally, Ray Vecchio. From Due South, of course. Now, he was very proud of his car, wasn't he? It was a big part of the story.
He was. It's green and it's a Buick.
It is, exactly. Yeah, it's a Buick Riviera. Fantastic. Very good.
3 for 3. Hold on there 1 second. Just wait a minute.
Listeners, I am on tenterhooks just as much as you are.
I've got something for you here. Look at that.
Oh, lovely. Lovely. It's a Corgi Spender Special Edition Ford Sierra diecast.
This is a 1/16th. Got it off eBay a little while ago. Opening doors, registration plate G325WVW, which is accurate to the series as well. It's really great to have that adorning one of the bookshelves in the house. It's always a little conversation starter.
Well, hopefully I can find a diecast of my new favourite detective's TV car.
Ooh,
because I have just discovered my new favourite TV detective's car. I've just started re-watching on ITVX Inspector Frost. Mm-hmm. Do you remember what car Inspector Frost drives? Now, I've actually only watched one episode, so it might change. But in the first episode, I'm going to assume this is his car for the series, or at least the early series. Can you remember what it is?
Now, I've never seen an episode of Inspector Frost. I'm afraid it's called A Touch of Frost, isn't it? It's not called Inspector Frost.
Yes.
I'm ashamed to say, but I know he's supposed to be a bit of a Columbo, shabby kind of guy.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Detective type, isn't he? So I would say nothing, certainly nothing like a Triumph Roadster or a Mark II Jag. Just for the yucks, I'll suggest it might be a Yugo, but I don't know. Go on.
That would be amazing. It's not actually that far off that. It's actually very, basically you just had it in your hand, because it's a Mark II Ford Sierra 1.6L. So a very a base model. Late 80s Ford Blue, my favourite Ford colour, bar none. And the registration is D843MPP, which makes it 86, 87. Now, Frost first aired in 92, so it's not, this is not a new car. This has been around on the road for about 5 years. And, of course, I went on a DVLA checker, and it's registered to a grey Mitsubishi. So I'm not sure what's going on there. There's a mystery within a mystery there. It's currently no longer registered on the road, which is unsurprising. But if anyone knows what happened to that Mitsubishi or the Sierra, or you want to get in touch and tell us what your favourite TV detective's car is, and we would love to hear from you. But I now have my favourite. Stu has his favourite. Both Ford Sierras. So let us know what yours is.
I know it's the case with TV cars, or it certainly used to be, that the car would often have a real registration plate and a prop registration plate. I know for a fact that the yellow Daimler that Arthur Daly drives in the glory years of Minder had a prop plate that was used on it. So that could be the case here. And then the prop plate was registered subsequently to a real car. But I guess we'll never know.
Yeah, interesting. Two more things on the bulletin board for you here, Stu. I've discovered a new contender for the most 90s slang term, which occurred to me for some reason this week, and that's tight. Describing something or someone as tight, as in don't be tight, to mean don't be unfair or don't be mean, which I think you don't get that anymore, do you? Have you heard, when was the last time you heard someone say that?
No, certainly not. Maybe tight as in being mean with money is the context in which you would hear it these days, but certainly not in any other. I have a clear memory of a dog waste bin on my walk home from primary school having the legend Paul Smith is tight written on the side in marker pen, and that was there for many years on the way home from Caution Primary School. So I don't know whether Paul Smith was indeed tight or not, but hey, Paul, if you're listening, come on, get in touch, let us know.
Yeah, and if you were tight, which form of tight were you? Were you a bit of a meanie, or were you just tight with money? Could go either way. But that's my contender for most 90s slang term for the week. It hadn't occurred to me for the last episode that we were interviewing an actual previous What's the Most 90s award winner. Because, of course, you chose Stiltskin, didn't you, for the most 90s British rock band. I hadn't registered. That's probably the first time we've actually had a most 90s winner on the pod.
Yes, yes, indeed. And we're proud to announce it next week. Craig Forrest is going to be on the show. would that we could. Would that we could. But no, you're quite right. That passed me by as well. I was going to say, if I got the chance again, what an episode that was last time out with Peter.
One other thing that has arrived in our PO box from, I don't know where exactly, this is sort of part of the issue with this great mystery that's going on behind the scenes here. This relates to a message we got from the newly installed dad of the pod. You'll probably remember from a few episodes ago that there were some goings on there and some connections to the Masons. Well, we've had another message from new dad of the pod into our Instagram account, which I will read out now. Ever since my elevation to the rank of dad of the pod, I've been listening assiduously to your podcast, and I must say it filled a pleasant hour or so between 11s and my pre-lunch nap. I was in the Masonic Lodge the other afternoon listening to a very interesting talk about the history and evolution of the Masonic handshake when Jeff sat down beside me and nudged me awake. "Here you go," he said, stuffing a £20 note into my top pocket, "on account." Well, the speaker had only got up to the mid-19th century reverse thumb handshake, so we withdrew to the smoking room and ordered a half bottle of Wincarnis. Jeff suggested I take advantage of my new status to give something back to the community by opening care homes, garden fetes, supermarkets and so on. Also, charge a small fee to cover admin expenses. He said he could probably set it up for me, but it would take a bit of seed money to get it going, so I gave him back the 20 quid and another tenner on top. He told me I shouldn't bother you two about it as you were so busy with research and rehearsals. "They rehearse that stuff," I quipped, but Jeff didn't seem to hear me. "Anyway, if you could drop a mention on my future public appearances into your pods, I'd be grateful. I can't do any in the near future as Alex's mother has been writing things on my face with an indelible felt-tip pen while I was asleep, and it'll take a week or two to wear off." So it sounds like more goings on. I don't like how much business around this podcast is conducted in the Masonic Hall.
No, I know. And it always seems to end up with us lining other people's pockets.
Yeah. Mainly Jeff's, by the sound of it. There may be more to come with that story. If you are approached by someone using the 19th century reverse thumb handshake, you know that's quite likely to be connected to this podcast, and we suggest that you walk away quickly. But
or if you come across anybody who's got felt tip pen writing on their face.
Yeah, exactly. So keep an eye open. There could well be some local buildings and fates and whatnot being opened by Dad of the Pod, which would be good. Could be a bit of publicity at least for us. I mean, that's the only good thing that could come out of this by the sound of it. But anyway, just another quick update on the shady goings on behind the scenes at this podcast.
I've got some 90s football shirt news for you.
I am always up for that. Please go ahead.
Cash your mind back, and we're going to be doing this a bit later on actually as well, but cash your mind back to our very first episode. Can you remember what the shirt was that I identified as my holy grail, the shirt to end all shirts, the one that I must add to my collection before I pass on from this mortal curl?
I think it was the Aston Villa Müller stained glass goalkeeper jersey.
Correct. 10 points. Very, very excitingly this week, one of these shirts has actually come up on eBay in an adult size. You only ever seem to get them in child sizes. I have a look every so often. There's one that's come up in a size large. I've been watching it on eBay. There's about 4 days left to go, and it's already up to £370. So I'm not sure I'm going to be able to justify dipping in my pocket. But then it's only going to appreciate in value, isn't it? So maybe I should suck it up now.
Let's treat it as an investment.
Yeah,
you never know.
Trigger.
Not that I want to put you off, but I would be... Is the bottom ever going to fall out of this market? Prompted by the last Aston Villa stained glass kit finally coming off the market, that might precipitate it, or everyone will start trying to flog them because they've seen how much they go for. That's always what I think. What's your pod salary again? I think we're paid the same on this, aren't we?
It's a nominal fee. I'm not at liberty to discuss it on the air, but it's a nominal fee. Let's put it like that.
It's probably not going to stretch to that, is it? So
I don't think so. I don't think you can purchase things on eBay with luncheon vouchers either anyway, so that could be a problem.
In that case, I think it's going to have to be left, isn't it? You're going to have to just watch the auction end with regret, but also safe in the knowledge that you have saved yourself a considerable amount of money, which you can spend on maybe 4 or 5 other shirts that you desire at just a bit less.
I will keep an eye on it. I'll make a note of the final price, and I will come back on the episode next time and let you know what it went for and how much money I saved. But yes, I'm afraid at this moment in time, I'm just going to have to let it go and be an interested bystander.
I think next time we do this pod, you'll come on the screen. You'll be wearing the top, but there'll be no furniture behind you.
The Spender Corky is going to have been sold. That's going to have gone.
Speaking of which, time now for today's What's the Most 90s. And Stu, I am asking you what the Most 90s rebrand is.
Mm-hmm. Well, this caused many ructions when it occurred in the 90s. I've gone for the rebrand of Opal Fruits to Starburst. Mm. This was such a huge thing in the late 90s. They've been called Opal Fruits since 1960. And here's a little bit of interesting information. They were named Opal Fruits by a chap called Peter Phillips. And then in brackets here, it says, but he was known as Peter Pfeffer at the time. A little bit of information for you there. And he won £5 for winning the competition to name the Opal Fruit Suite. So I hope he invested that well. Maybe he used it at the Depot office to change his name from Pfeffer to Phillips. Who knows? But they were known as Opal Fruits, globally, right up until 1998, when they were phased out in the UK and of course, turned into Starburst, which they still are now. I don't really have a lot to say about the background or the history of the change. It was obviously a successful change because it's been Starburst ever since that change in 1998. It's never gone back. But Opal Fruits is just a much better name. I just prefer Opal Fruits to Starburst in every conceivable way. It sounds quaint. It sounds British. Obviously, this was a rebrand. Oh, we've got to judge the name. We have to make it something more exciting and something that's going to pop out on the shelves. But there was nothing wrong with Opal Fruits. I'm partial to an Opal Fruit from time to time. I still call them Opal Fruits myself. I'm still carrying that flag. But yes, I've gone for the change from Opal Fruits to Starburst.
Mm, yeah, it's a good one. I think Opal Fruits also, it makes your mouth water, just that name, whereas Starburst doesn't sound necessarily like a sweet. But I think it was rebranded to bring it in line with existing products around the world. That's why it was done. The same as Snickers to,
right,
to Marathon and Jif to Sif. It's because they just wanted to have one name mm-hmm. everywhere rather than different ones. Not that that's an excuse. There's no, there is no excuse for it. It's a disgrace. But it's a, yeah, I had notes on this as well. So it was definitely one I was thinking of. But my answer is also from the year 1998. Possibly even more of a controversy at the time, because it is the rebranding of Coco Pops to Choco Krispies, which, as we all know, caused such uproar. It led to a million signatures on a petition, a national petition, which was handed over to the people at Big Cereal. I'm not sure who. Oh, Kellogg's. To Kellogg's, that's their name. And it was reversed, yeah. So this was a very rare, possibly the only example of the decade, and the only one I can think of, where a rebrand has been reversed because it was so unpopular. And it was another example of the company trying to bring the name in line with national, international branding, where it was already known as Choco Krispies, and I think it still is. But we just, we, you know, we pulled together the Blitz spirit, and that's what can happen with people power. And on our shelves to this day, it's still Coco Pops.
Mm-hmm. I suppose with Rice Krispies, Choco Krispies makes sense to have them as a duo. Mm. They are, in effect, the same cereal, one just has a different flavouring. But again, Coco Pops, Choco Krispies. Coco Pops is the far superior name. Rolls off the tongue, very, very familiar, very, very famous. And it just goes to show that these activities where products are rebranded in order to bring them into line across the world, sometimes are unnecessary, sometimes they don't work, sometimes people don't want them. We know what Coco Pops are. We don't need to have them renamed to make them similar to another cereal that you also have.
I think we are all agreed on that. And you'll find many people across the country, I think, still referring to Opal Fruits and maybe even Marathons. Although that's quite interesting, isn't it? That we were born post, sorry, we weren't born, but we were raised and came of age post rebrand with the Snickers from Marathon, that I never felt like I should still keep calling it Marathon because it meant anything to me. But maybe, I guess, as young people now who will just always know them as Starburst and will, you know, think of us as granddads for being upset about the demise of Opal Fruits. But such is, that's the world of nostalgia, I suppose.
So are we suggesting then that we should rename Gen Z as the Starburst generation?
I think we should, yeah. Or alternatively, we can refer to ourselves as the Opal Fruit generation. Either way, let's just start referring to every generation based on the rebranding of sweets and cereals based in that period.
I like it. That's something I can get behind. But what's going to go in the ledger?
I mean, they're the same. They're so similar, aren't they? I don't know how you choose one or the other. I feel more strongly about Opal Fruits, I think, than I do about Coco Pops. So let's put them in.
Well, the other thing, of course, to bear in mind is that People Power did get Coco Pops changed back. Whereas, of course, Starburst is still Starburst. And the 90s Opal Fruit name did die out at that point. So maybe on that basis, the Opal Fruit should go in the ledger.
Yeah, okay, let's do it.
I'll have a blackcurrant one, please, if you've got one.
Hey, you know what? They've stopped doing... They've amalgamated lemon and lime into one green sweet. There's no yellow ones anymore.
You're joking.
I know, it gets worse, doesn't it?
It's clearly been a while since I've had some Starburst then, because I had no idea. I should just say, before we wrap up, what's the most 90s rebrand? That subject came courtesy of wife of the pod, Beth. Many thanks to her for coming up with that one and taking some of the pressure off of us to keep coming up with subjects to speak about. Very much appreciated by me. Just time for a little bit of anecdote roulette. Alex, I've got some new entries onto the list this time round. So let me give you the full list of everything that's here, because last time I only gave you a couple of options. Let me remind you of the full set, and then you can choose which one you want to hear about. So we've got, still at the top of the list, is the biggest telling off I ever received at primary school. We've got running into a plate glass window at a branch of Argos. We've got Angus Deaton's one foot in the groin. We've got trapped in a Jaguar. We've got mother's decorative plates. We've got the time I attended a Christian festival by accident. Or we've got the man with a salt packet stuck to his bum. Which one of those would you like?
They're all such enticing headlines. I'm going to go for Angus Deaton's one foot in the crotch.
Well, it's one foot in the groin.
One foot in the groin, okay, there you go.
Yes. Angus Deaton's one foot in the groin really is it's a coverall for a topic that I think actually we could maybe do a full episode on one of these days if we ever get the chance, which is the 90s Christmas stocking filler VHS, of which there were hundreds. And of course, the king of the genre is Danny Baker's own Goals and Gaffes. I don't think anybody would ever dispute that, maybe with Nick Hancock's Football Nightmares, etc., coming a close second. They were all at it in the mid-90s, and one such tape was Angus Deaton's One Foot in the Groin, which I bought from a charity shop when I was about 11 or 12. So during this time, around about the early to mid-2000s, when people were beginning to switch from VHS to DVD players, lots and lots of VHSs were starting to turn up in charity shops. And I would go around the charity shops in Corsham, Chippenham, wherever I was, and see if I could find any of these sorts of tapes, because I absolutely love them. Danny Baker's Own Goals and Gaffes was the first one I ever had, and that was my gateway drug. After that, I would try and find any tape I could find that was of that bent. And I found Angus Deaton's One Foot in the Groin, who I knew from Have I Got News For You, obviously, and One Foot in the Grave, also, hence the title. And this resurfaced on YouTube recently. I've been waiting for somebody to digitize it and put it on YouTube for some time so that I could watch it again. It's a particularly poor effort. It's an hour of clips of sports people. It's not necessarily things going wrong, but it's cheating, bad tackles, fighting, that sort of area. And it's famous for containing a tackle by a Southampton player called Tommy Witherington, which happened during a cup tie against Port Vale, which I've never seen anywhere else. It was only ever a clip on that video, and it's the worst tackle I've ever seen, and I'm not sure he even gets booked.
A cup tie between Southampton and Port Vale gives Tommy Witherington the opportunity to kick John Jeffers in the Dell.
So it's full of stuff like that, but I just wanted to really tell you about my addiction to VHSs of this ilk during that time period, the ones that came out in the 90s. Neil Morrissey's Footballers Behaving Badly is another particularly bad effort I recall. which again, if anybody's got that and they're able to put it up on YouTube, please do, because I'd love to see that again. It's very, very bad. I think Neil even said so himself in an episode of Fantasy Football League that he was on around the time. He said, don't buy it, it's crap. And I hope, with your agreement, I could take you through my favourites of the genre in a more detailed way. But yes, that's One Foot in the Groin for you.
Fantastic. I like that. The only videos like that I had, I'm slightly ashamed to say, are Jeremy Clarkson videos. They were sort of Top Gear adjacent, so things like, I can't remember the name, Car Carnage and Car Apocalypse and stuff like that, which I did really like. And there are still those tapes in my parents' house somewhere, tucked away.
Yeah, he did those when DVDs replaced VHSs. He continued to do those for years and years and years. And they all have the same theme music. I'll play some in on the edit here so you can hear the Clarkson VHS theme music, because that stayed the same for 20 years.
Greetings and welcome to one of the great debates of the modern age. What is the best car in the world ever? Well, I don't know. Guess we'll just have to go find out.
So on to the main subject of today's episode, which is crime in the 90s. We've each picked a couple of the crimes that stick in our minds from the decade to discuss in a bit further detail. Alex, why don't you kick us off with your first notable crime of the decade?
So my first choice is actually two crimes rolled into one. So this was two crimes that happened in the mid and late 90s. On September the 7th, 1996, Tupac Shakur was shot and killed when he was aged 25 by unknown assailants in a drive-by shooting in Las Vegas. And then on the 8th of March 1997, after the Soul Train Awards in LA, Biggie Smalls, or Christopher Wallace to give him his real name, was gunned down also by unknown assailants in a drive-by shooting. So I think everyone will know about these murders now. They are something that has just been written about, talked about for every year since they happened, I think. And as much as this is obviously a 90s podcast, the Tupac murder especially is actually quite topical at the moment, because I don't know if you noticed this in the news, Stu, that a character called Dwayne Keith Keefe D. Davis was arrested and charged with Tupac's murder in September this year. So it's just happened after, what is that, 30 years now? That it's almost 30 years since it happened. But I've chosen them because I just think they're, like I said, they're so inextricably linked to the 90s. And they are key elements in the history of gangster rap, which was hitting its peak in the mid-90s, early to mid-90s, with people like Tupac and Biggie Smalls representing the West Coast and the East Coast, respectively. And it was a culmination of the rivalry between those two coasts. And so, yeah, I think they are crimes that are linked to a specific moment in a specific genre of the 90s. Obviously, the musical output of both artists hasn't really been hindered too much by their deaths, especially Tupac, who has continued to release music ever since. We obviously talked about changes on the episode we did with Channel Lem on the Random Chart of 99, which is a song that I've grown to like more and more over the years. In the episode, I did allude to the final lyrics of the final verse being very haunting, considering what happened to Tupac subsequently, and I do again urge people to go and listen to that. In fact, we might put a clip in here if we can get it past the YouTube censors. It won't work if I read it out. It's a sort of lyric that, just if I, in my Northwest Wiltshire accent, read it off a page on this podcast, it's not really going to have the same impact. So I will let Tupac say it himself. I bust this, that's the sound number two. You say it ain't cool, my mama didn't raise no fool. And as long as I stay black, I got a stage strap, and I never get to lay back, cause I always gotta worry about the payback. Some buck that I roughed up way back, coming back after all these years. Right, tat, 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 tat. That's the way it is. That's just the way it is. But it's, yeah, it's a great song, and obviously many albums as well released by Tupac. And of course, Puff Daddy, who released I'll Be Missing You in 1997 after the death of Biggie Smalls, which was a number one in the UK. I think everyone knows that, the sample of Every Breath You Take by Sting being the basis of the song. It was a massive song with a very famous video. And this does allow me to bring to your attention, Stu, one of my favourite YouTube videos, which I am frequently found to be watching in a sort of, with a sort of grim fascination, basically.
Right, hold on.
I've sent you
a
link to it.
Has Bobby Davro falling over in the stocks got to do with this?
That's a different YouTube video that I watch all the time.
Okay, let's have a look here. I'm intrigued.
But imagine the song they would have written about Bobby Davro if he died in that accident. So, Stu, the main thing I think you need to watch out for in this video is, well, firstly, Sting's great vocal harmonies, which are genuinely good. They're not on the recorded track, of course, but I think they really, really work really well on the live version, and Faith Evans' live vocal being really great as well. But then on the other side of the seesaw of quality is Puff Daddy's dancing, which I think will come in after the choir's been singing. You'll see it shortly. Let me know when he comes through the door.
I will do. Okay, so just for the listeners, this is Puff Daddy, as he was known then, performing I'll Be Missing You with Faith Evans and Sting at the 1997 MTV VMAs. So let's see what happens. Okay, so we've got a large choir and some VT of Biggie Smalls on the screen. And here they come. That's considering the content and what the song's about, that's mind-boggling.
It's some movement, isn't it?
It is.
It's akin to an injured pigeon flapping around the stage.
And here's Mr. Sting, yeah.
Yeah, I think Sting is probably glad that he can't see what's going on behind him, because I think he's at the front of the stage, isn't he? So,
yeah.
God knows what Faith Evans thinking.
Wow, that is really something.
Anyway, yeah, there you go. Also at the end, he does say, Biggie Smalls, so say clap your hand to Princess Diana. So that's nice for the royalists among the audience. But that aside, I wanted to choose those murders just because it gave me another opportunity to talk about gangster rap in the 90s, which is something I'm very fond of. And needless to say, it was a massive loss for the world of rap and music as a whole. I think Biggie considered one of the greatest rappers of all time. Tupac was one of the most unique rappers and like a really important voice for social justice which was at a time when that was quite rare in rap music. So, yeah, big losses. And that was my first choice.
I've only just realised, after having looked it up, because I was scared that I was making some sort of mistake, that Biggie Smalls and the Notorious B.I.G. are the same person.
Mm. It took me a long time to work that out as well. So that's totally fair enough.
For my first choice, I've gone for a slightly different crime. And I want to take you back to where it all began, Alex, for us. Nearly, what's coming up for 3 years now that this happened. So can you remember what it was that kicked us off down this path and got us to 65 odd episodes of this podcast as we sit here today? Can you remember what it was that started it all off for us?
I assume is the Hell for Leather thrilling chase along the M25, which appeared on Police Camera Action at some point in a decade, which you posted on my Facebook wall, I guess, 2 or 3 years ago. We were commenting on the great 90s cars in it and the whole world of Police Camera Action. And then I think one of us said we should do a podcast on this, something like that. And then lo and behold, a few weeks later, you messaged me saying, no, seriously, should we do a podcast on this? And here we are, 2 and a bit years later, talking about crime.
Well, it only seemed right to give a tip of the hat to our OG video clip that we did a watch along of. This took place on the 27th of November, 1990. So as we record, we're only 5 days away from the 35th anniversary of this particular crime. For those of you who haven't seen it, we'll put a link in the episode description, of course. But this is, as Alex says, a chase down the M25 between a red and white transit van, which was ferrying a couple of burglars and their trove, which they had been, before the clip starts, they had been throwing it out of the van in order to try and get rid of the evidence because they were now being chased by the police. They're trying to use the M25 to get away from the police. And it doesn't end all that well for them, does it? It's a very famous Police Camera Action clip. And possibly, apart from the liver run, of course, the liver run notwithstanding, I think my favourite clip of the entire Police Camera Action canon. I was going to suggest to you, as the clip is only about 4.5 minutes long, do you think we should do a little mini watch along now?
I think it would be insulting not to.
Okay, let's get queued up.
Two men in the red and white van are on the run along the M25 after a burglary. The police are eager to keep them on the motorway. Not only is it safer for the public, but it also makes it easier to control the pursuit until backup forces arrive.
So, as I said, it's the 27th of November, 1990. It's 3:25 in the afternoon. Alex, what can you tell us about the vehicles in the early part of this chase?
Well, the police car that is most prominently in shot. Oh, hang on. There's a Pickford's removal van there in that classic blue and red livery, which I do love. But the police car that we can see, not the one that's is filming, but the one that is on camera is a Rover 800, possibly a Vitesse. It's definitely a fastback with the jam sandwich livery, doing a good job of keeping it steady.
You've seen the first incident there of the police car driving on the inside lane to keep the van on the motorway. What the police want to avoid is the van getting off the motorway and causing more danger to the public in more built-up areas and built-up roads. So they've kept them on the motorway for the time being.
It's quite a dramatic time of day for the chase, isn't it? It's quite a stunning sunset happening to the left of the screen there, which really adds some drama to it.
The sun setting over Greater London. And we've got two, you can even see the silhouettes of the two occupants of the van.
Yeah, I love that.
Iconic rear windows of the transit.
Yeah, it's funny because just seeing their silhouettes of their heads, they just look quite calm because they're just motionless, you know, slightly moving to the right and left a little bit. But it sort of gives it a slightly cartoonish edge, which I like.
They're keeping well within the speed limit at this point as well.
Yeah, well, they don't want another thing on the book, do they? Don't want another.
No, I suppose not. No, there's enough going on.
just passing a Peugeot 405 there that was keeping pace for a while there. Oh, I think there's a Mark IV Escort that's just being overtaken in the slow lane. Probably will not be interesting to the listeners if I just list every car that I see, but it's very hard to resist.
There's quite an iconic moment of the video has just gone past there when one of the burglars throws a remote control out of the passenger window in order to try and dispose of some more evidence. I suppose that's quite a good thing. You don't want a VCR bouncing along the motorway towards you, do you? When you've got no way to try and avoid it.
Do you reckon they were throwing stuff out in the order that they least cared about it? So they like they were really hoping that they didn't have to throw out the big TV. So they would just get rid of all the other stuff first. And then eventually...
It would have been a big TV in those days as well, wouldn't it?
Yeah,
it would have been a big one, definitely.
Big tube one, yeah.
So we're coming up to another motorway exit that the police driver is going to expertly block off. But the police car gets forced off. The van stays on the motorway.
Very clever getaway driving there.
Oh,
hang on. So what's happened, Stu?
Well, we've now cut to a couple of minutes later, I think, and there is now a Mark 1 or 2 police Range Rover weaving across the lanes.
There's some body roll there, isn't there?
Somehow managing to look even more unstable than the van itself. Yeah. Oh, this is really something else.
You can see the silhouette of the police driver there as well. Somehow keeping upright.
I think the passenger in the police Range Rover starts waving out of the window, and there he goes.
Oh yeah. Yeah, I'm not sure what they were waving, if they're waving to the cameras or is that, what is that police car coming down the fast lane now? Is that a Sierra Estate?
That was exactly what I was going to say. Yes. Anyway, here comes the most iconic moment of the entire chase, which comes at the very end of the chase. The van finally decides to leave the motorway and immediately at the top of the junction, top of the slip road, crashes.
With another junction coming up, police move to surround the van and again try to keep it on the M25. It escapes, but not for long.
He's crashed at junction 23.
Very, very much pre-ABS brakes, wasn't it, this era?
Very much so, very much so. So that is one of my favourite crimes of the 90s. It's a clip I've watched often. I'm not sure I've watched it as often as you've watched Puff Daddy's Dancing on the other clip, but it's one that I've always enjoyed.
There's similar levels of unwieldiness in both videos, isn't there, I think?
Are we suggesting that Puff Daddy's Dancing is akin to the body roll of an early Range Rover?
I think we might be, yeah.
Interestingly, the passenger in the red and white van got a longer prison sentence than the driver did.
He must have said something.
I guess so.
Oh, well, I wonder where they are now. If you are listening, if you were in that transit van and you're listening to this podcast, please do get in touch because we would love to hear from you. Tell us from your point of view what happened.
Yeah, if you were there, if you were the 405 driver just holding it steady in the middle lane while everything went on around you, please do let us know. Absolutely, we'd love to hear from you.
You know, someone somewhere in this country was moving house on that day and all their belongings were in that Pickford's lorry and they'll never know how famous their belongings were for one moment in the 90s.
Exactly. These are the things, these are the important questions that this podcast tasks itself with answering.
Yeah, exactly.
This is what the people want.
Yeah.
Who was moving house? Who had their stuff going down the M25 in late November 1990 when all that was kicking off at the same time? We want to know, and we won't rest until we find out.
For my second choice, then, let me see if you can work out what it is, Stu. 7th of April 1998, Will Rogers Memorial Park, Beverly Hills. Any idea?
Would this involve one George Michael, by any chance?
It will indeed involve George Michael. A public restroom. George Michael is arrested by an undercover police officer, Marcelo Rodriguez, in a sting operation for engaging in lewd behaviour, which is obviously something that was very big news in this country and in America as well, I'm sure, being that George Michael was a huge name and still is. Obviously, he's no longer with us, but is a massive name in pop history. In the words of Michael himself, George Michael, it's weird, you know, when I refer to George Michael, you either call him George or you call him Michael, and neither sounds quite right.
Yeah, true.
But in an MTV interview subsequent to the event, Michael stated, "I got followed into the restroom and then this cop, I didn't know he was a cop, obviously, he started playing this game, which I think is called, I'll show you mine, you show me yours, and then when you show me yours, I'm going to nick you," which I thought was quite a funny way of him describing the situation, which is obviously, almost tore his career apart, but he's always seemed to have had some good humour about it. So the legal results were, of course, he pleaded no contest to the charge. He got a small nominal fine of less than $1,000 and was sentenced to 80 hours of community service. And that, so that was the legal results, but then the personal results, I think, were much more satisfying. So having been confronted with this, I think it's probably safe to say, fairly homophobic policing action that threatened to ruin his career and his personal life. He could have, obviously, he could have gone into hiding. He could have retreated from it entirely. He could have pretended it didn't happen. He could have been and would have been very justified in being very angry about it all. But instead of all that, he came up with what I think is the absolute perfect response to this travesty, which is, of course, the video for Outside, which was released in October of the same year. Anyone who doesn't know, we will post a link to the video below. The video is set partly inside a grimy public toilet, which at a certain point in the song transforms into a fabulous glitter ball adorned dance floor slash public toilet. So the urinals turn around and then they're replaced by really shiny chrome plated urinals, and there's a glitter ball and disco lights, and Michael is of course dressed as an LA cop, or a sexy LA cop, a very tight uniform, and it's basically the perfect response that he could have given. I think it's the equivalent of blowing a raspberry in musical form, I think, to the LAPD and all of the homophobes who were probably relishing the arrest when it first happened. Subsequent to this, the policeman in question, Rodriguez, claimed that the video was mocking him and took or tried to take George Michael to court. I think he was asking for several million dollars for it, but the judge threw it out, saying that there was no case basically, and that you can't take it to court if you're a public official like that. So it was a very satisfying result in that respect as well. And so, yeah, that's why I've chosen it. I think it was a pretty unpleasant, unseemly event tinged with homophobia, and it was turned around into a great triumph, I think. And as we've all subsequently found out, after his very sad death in 2016, George Michael, it turned out, was a very, very good egg, and he's sadly missed. So I think this might be one of his greatest triumphs. So I wanted to add something a little bit more upbeat for this episode, and that's why I've chosen it.
That's a great choice. My mum, a huge George Michael fan, had Outside on CD single. I remember the video well. And as you say, it's the absolute correct response and just worked so well in repairing what little damage his reputation had actually suffered as a result of this. I think he also had a Parkinson's special not long afterwards. I think he says something like, "In future, I'll keep my willy where nobody can see it," or something like that. I think that's what he says, just to sort of refer to it and break the ice over it, you know. But no, an absolutely wonderful choice. I couldn't agree more with that.
So what's your second choice then, Stu?
What would you say has been the biggest football story in the news over the last 7 days as we record this?
I'd say it would have to be Everton's financial penalty, being docked 10 points for some financial irregularities.
Absolutely. Well, I want to talk about a similar type of crime that happened a lot closer to home. I want to talk about Swindon Town in the early 1990s and the illegal payment scandal that engulfed the club up until 1992. There's an unofficial Swindon Town YouTube channel which has very, very helpfully edited together about 15 minutes of local news reports from the time that tells the entire story in sequence. So this is from BBC Local News and ITV Local News. And it's great to see some of the really well-loved local anchors in action in this clip. People like Bruce Hockin, Patricia Yorston, who I think we've mentioned on the podcast before. So it's worth looking at the video for that alone.
The judge of the First Division told a fraud trial today of the huge amounts of money they were paid in illegal deals. Swindon's former manager, Lou McCurry, the former chairman, Brian Hillier, and accountant, Vince Farrer, all deny tax evasion charges. One player said he was given £1,500 tax-free just because he was getting married. Simon Whitby now reports from Winchester Crown Court.
Chris Kamara told the jury today how his basic wage was routinely topped up by undeclared cash payments. He, like other players who will be giving evidence, has been granted immunity from prosecution.
So basically this began in 1985 and carried on until around 1990 when Brian Hillier took over the chairmanship of the club and appointed the former Manchester United player Lou McCurry as manager. Basically, the club weren't able to afford players of a standard that would get them promoted through the divisions due to Football League rules. So what they did in order to get around that was just make bonus payments, give players cash payments, give them houses, cars, etc., on the side that weren't declared to the taxman in order to attract a better class of player to the club. Subsequently, they achieved successive promotions from the fourth to the first division in 5 years. So between 1985 and 1990, they actually rose up through the entire league up to the first division. The payments varied between players. According to the news reports I watched, Chris Kamara, who was at the club at the time, was being given an extra £30 a week in cash, while the captain, while the captain, Ross McLaren, was given £20,000 tax-free for a house and also £150 per week in order to pay off a loan he'd taken out on a car. So clearly some players worth more illegal payments than others. So Swindon achieved promotion to the First Division in 1990, but then were found guilty of 36 charges of financial irregularities. Sunderland were promoted in their place, and the punishment was that Swindon Town would be relegated to the third division. So they've been relegated two divisions during the off-season. They were supposed to be in the first division. They were relegated to the third. On appeal, they were allowed to go back to the second division, basically, where they had started the season before. So that punishment was commuted to just being effectively relegated at one division. On the 29th of July 1992, when this all came to a head in court, the manager, Lou Macari, was cleared of all tax offences. It had been said that Macari and Hillier were the main men behind the scheme. Hillier and the accountant Farrow were both found guilty, and Hillier went to prison for 1 year. Farrow received a suspended six-month prison sentence. One addendum to this is that when his ban from football expired, he was banned for football for 3 years as well. Brian Hillier actually came back into the local game, and he was chairman of Calmtown, a team that's local to both of us where we grew up, for many years and retained that position until his death in 2008. So Brian Hillier did eventually return to football in the end. But there we go. With what's going on in the news at the moment regarding Everton, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the original illegal payment scandal from the 1990s involving Swindon Town, or Swindle Town, as they became known during that period.
I imagine that probably looks like quite small fry compared to some of the dealings that go on in the Premier League era these days. And obviously Everton has just been busted for it. Whether that's fair or not, I don't know the details, but that's such a harsh punishment, isn't it? To go down two divisions for that crime. So I think, I mean, being docked 10 points for Everton seems pretty lenient compared to that. But I would absolutely love to see Man City playing in League Two next season. So fingers crossed that the same detectives get involved in that particular football club. But I won't hold my breath.
Another thing to look out for, if you do watch the YouTube clip that I watched, is some flashes of the Swindon kit at the time, which had the GWR-FM sponsor with the classic pink and blue logo for GWR at the time, which is obviously fantastic. But yeah, no, an interesting one.
Yeah, it's nice. And nice to have something a little bit local as well.
Always keep it local. When it comes to financial irregularity, keep it local.
From the streets of Las Vegas to the magic roundabout, we've got you covered.
So then that was crime in the 90s. We're going to leave the illegal activity behind now and move on to tell you about what we've got coming up and the various other things that are going on. Alex, did you enjoy that little dip into the murky past of the 90s?
Yeah, it was interesting. It was something a little bit different for us, wasn't it? A little bit edgy, a bit risky. But I think we pulled it off without going too dark. And I can't deny I'm a big fan of true crime and detective and police procedurals on TV. So there's definitely something that I have an interest in. But good episode, I thought.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's nice to pull back from the edge again, isn't it? And get back to a more safe distance.
Exactly, yeah. Which is something I think we'll be doing next week. Is that right?
It is, yes. Next time, it's going to be our Christmas episode. It's the most wonderful time of the year. And we're finally, after 12 months, coming back to do part two of the 90s Christmas number ones countdown with our very, very good friends, Catherine and Dan, from the Now That's What I Call Bullshit pod. We're really looking forward to that one, aren't we?
Yeah, it's going to be great. That was such a good episode last year. It feels like it was only a couple of months ago. I can't believe it's been a year, but
I know.
Can't wait to get back on that and potentially libel some other 60s and 70s pop stars.
We also may have a live event in the works for the new year. We're still finalising the details on that, but we will let you know everything as soon as we've got that sorted out. But it's something that we're really looking forward to and really excited to do if we can do it. We're very hopeful that it's all going to get organised. And yeah, we'll let you know as soon as it has been.
If you want to get in touch with us and talk about some 90s crimes that we haven't already mentioned, or ones that we have mentioned and you've got some more details or some comments, or if you want to get in touch about anything we've ever talked about on the pod, then please do so using the links in our link tree below, which will be linked as always. We would love to hear from you.
Anything you've got on any 90s subject, our lines of communication are always open. We would love to hear from you. Until next time, when we speak to Catherine and Dan about the Christmas number ones from 1995 to 1999, it's goodbye from me. I'm just off to jump in my red and white Transit and nip down the M25.
And I'm just off to jump in my Rove 800 Vitesse jam sandwich and pursue you all the way. He's crashed!
He's crashed at Junction 23.